Hi there, welcome to part 2 of an ongoing series where I aim to build a 5-axis 3D printer. Today I will show some changes and additions into the physical 3D printer that I am currently building, highlighting some key details and decisions I made along the way. The printer has significantly evolved since the last video, now featuring a frame partially complete with the basic necessary components for all 5 axes in place. Some end stops were strategically positioned and everything was wired up. I have also installed Octoprint with Clipper. This allows me to proceed with other interesting parts of the build. Next, I will start working on kinematics, but before that, let's discuss what has been happening so far. First, let's touch on some general notes about the frame. I would like to call it for what it is, a prototype intended to validate the idea and movement. It will undoubtedly undergo substantial changes over time. Many parts were chosen simply because they were available at hand. However, as I continue building, I run into issues, take notes, and subsequently order new pieces online that I will later replace in this build. That's a way for me to continue with other aspects while waiting for delivery that can take a while where I live. One noteworthy point is that I have allowed some parts to extend beyond the frame. For instance, I have placed motors and belts outside the frame. This approach is less restrictive, eases the design and assembly, and it also enables me to replace the parts with problems much quicker. In future, I would like to make an effort to move all the components inside the frame, even if that means sacrificing some printing space. This would enable me to enclose the printer if I ever want to. Having a rectangular printer that cannot be easily enclosed seems like a poor design choice. Next, let's examine the X and Y axes. Why did I opt for Neman 23 over Neman 17 motors? Well, I already had them, along with the stepper drivers. I initially bought them intending to increase the speed of my old 3D printer. If you want to make a printer faster, there are two main routes. Either reduce the gantry weight or modify the printer to handle a heavier gantry. Considering that I initially planned to rotate the printing head along two more axes, rather than the printing bed like I ended up doing. For my case, I hypothesized that I needed heavy duty motors to move a heavier gantry. Although I didn't go into that direction, I will leave it for the potential gain in speed, but it's definitely something we can optimize in the future. Another thing to note is the layout for X and Y, known as Core XY. I devised my own implementation of it in Fusion 360 to rotate the gantry 90 degrees, creating mirrored sides and offsetting them vertically, simplifying the design. The problem was that I didn't know if it was going to work until I tried X and Y movements through the electronics, which I now did, and it seems to be working just as expected. My goal here was to use the motor's tightening mechanism to simultaneously tighten the belt. The approach of my old Hypercube, which is tightening the belt at the print head, didn't appeal to me, so I went for this option. Not perfect though, as it seems to require three hands to do it comfortably, but I still prefer it. Another aspect of this setup that I am not particularly fond of is that I had to depend on these carriages. It was a choice between using them right now or waiting about a month for delivery. So I used what I had available at the moment and moved forward. Then I ordered a set of linear rails for the Y axis, which arrived yesterday. However, due to an error, I received shorter rails than what I needed. Since we are already talking about replacing carriages with linear rails, I will mention that I will also have to transition the Z axis to use linear rails. Fortunately, that part of the order was correct. Many people have previously commented that using those carbon rods is a mistake, and they are totally right. So let's explore why they are right. Firstly, those rods are flexible, which is a trait not ideal for this scenario. Look at the seed wobble of my rods, it's absolutely terrible. The carbon rods tend to bend, and that will cause the entire printed part to mimic that wobble. If the rods were rigid, at least they could resist the force of the wobble produced by the lead screw and mitigate the issue. I suggest checking out the work done by another creator on this matter. I have linked his channel in the description. But that's not the end of the argument against the carbon rods. They also have poor tolerances, resulting in bearings being either too loose or too tight. Seems to me they are just not ideal for this type of application. Plus they are more expensive, and their only real advantage, which is weight saving, is negated since this is a completely static part. I had anticipated this, but the reality is worse than I thought. It was good to try carbon fiber given my limited experience with the material, so I can learn about it, but I won't continue to use them here in this project. Another insight from this part of the design is that I don't really need to spread the rails this much. While this makes sense when dealing with a heat bed, for this case we can focus our attention only on the center of the U-axis, so the rails could be closer, saving weight on unnecessary aluminum and plastic. With the changes I am planning for the X, Y and Z, the design will look much leaner and be even easier to assemble. Alright, that is enough about the traditional axes. Let's move on to the new ones. This is where things get a bit murky, and it will require some experimentation to get right. As you can see, the U and B axes are now assembled. The motors are in place, and there is even one end stop for the U axis. The V axis, on the other hand, will have a full 360 degrees of rotation, and won't require an end stop. Whether or not this is practical or even desirable remains to be seen. For the U axis, the first issue became apparent as soon as I made a movement through the motors and electronics. Notice this backlash? That is quite problematic. It will produce effects similar to ghosting or ringing. At the moment, it's just too much. I don't see how any print can succeed if I leave it as it is. At the best, print quality would be absolutely terrible. The bad part of this issue is that I suspect there isn't just one cause, but several. I have three main suspects. First, the belt may be too elastic for this amount of weight. Second, the entire U-axis may be too heavy for this small motor, resulting in too much inertia that the motor struggles to hold. Third, the combination of plastic and aluminum has some play and is somewhat elastic. Here are a few solutions I have in mind. Option 1, change the gear ratio. I have various pulleys, so by changing the ratio, I could potentially add torque to the movement at the cost of reducing the final speed. Option 2, ditch pulleys and belts altogether, and opt for a direct drive. I find this option rather appealing. It could simplify the assembly and reduce the number of parts, which is always a win. However, this will involve some math to calculate the right motor size, so I will leave it for later. For now, let's stick with the pulleys approach, to experiment with different speeds and torques. Option 3. Add another motor in mirror to this one. This idea appeals to my preference for symmetry, but it means extra parts and higher costs. Perhaps I will consider this as a last resort if I run out of options. Option 4. Make the U gantry lighter and more efficient. This is something I will have to do eventually if I want to achieve a sleek design. Let's put a pin on it for now. Option 4 is gonna have to happen at some point anyways. Another concern is that the U-axis may become the bottleneck in terms of speed. I anticipate numerous failed prints before achieving something that resembles success. So I want to construct a device that is reasonably fast. Say so, I will likely choose overkill in most scenarios in the pursuit of potential speed. Now, observe this. Notice how this side has more space than the other one. That is because the motor is in the way. Then it occurred to me that the better idea would be to mount the motor on the top, reclaiming that space. In any case, the heatbed would never reach it if it's up. By doing this, I can optimize the use of space and also have the freedom to replace the motor with a bigger one if needed. Now, let's discuss the materials. These aluminum extrusions are incredibly useful in projects like this. They are easy to cut, easy to assemble, and you can construct almost any structure you need. One of the ways to fasten one piece to another is to tap holes in the center of the extrusion. I have mixed feelings about this approach because I am terrible at tapping holes. Almost every time I attempt to tap some hole, I end up breaking it up, leaving it forever embedded within my machine. Also, when this happens, the hole becomes unusable. This is what happened here with this part, and for that reason, I added those small gears to the axis holder. I didn't end up using them now, but in the future, I will try to avoid having to tap holes. On the other hand, when the process goes smoothly, assembly is a delight. Just look at this. Another decision I made was to use 2040 extrusions for the U assembly, which was a compromise between stiffness and weight. This is just the first iteration, and I am still convinced it's a good choice, but only time will tell. Now, who do I know if the motor will have enough power to move all of this reliably? The truth is, I don't know yet. I will play around with the pulleys first, and then try the other strategies I mentioned earlier. For now, I am leaning towards a practical approach, leaving mathematical calculations for the refinement stage of this frame. Someone in the comments suggested I could use curved rails here. I wasn't aware of this resource, but at first glance it looks expensive. I will try to make it work with less costly materials first. Alright, let's proceed. Now onto the B axis. My initial vision was more or less like this, but honestly I thought the entire assembly was going to be lighter and smaller, and not this ugly. I dislike this part as soon as I finish assembling it. The idea is to make the print bed that's smaller than a traditional one. A bigger one would limit the degrees of rotation of view and make me worry about collisions way too early. This size of printing bed should be sufficient to try something. Also, I think this is another offender when it comes to weight efficiency and will drastically reduce the top speed of the printer. Let's test this setup as it stands to see how it performs. But I am certain that I will have to modify parts of it. For now, let's just check its weight. The pulley I have used is actually quite heavy, and just by finding a better combination of pulleys and motor sizes, I should be able to shed some weight from here. Similar conclusions that the ones I enumerated for you do apply here as well. For example, I could switch to a direct drive setup if I find the right motor size to achieve the desirable speed and torque ratio. One of the major flaws of this build is the bearing I used. It's either of poor quality or just not suitable for this kind of application. I am planning to replace that to minimize the V axis tilt that will definitely pose a problem when printing. That tilt can be seen at plain sight if you pay attention to this part. I have naively used these 4 screws here to level the bed, but that's rather pointless effort. Even if I level the bed to the nozzle, this platform will rotate and everything will go out of whack real quick. One of the options is to use a thrust bearing instead, or maybe even 2. I am still figuring this out. I imagine I can minimize the undesirable tilt, but I don't think I can remove it altogether mechanically due to the imprecise nature of the components I am using. I think the trick with 3D printers will have to be to create routines that can compensate for imperfections, analogous to the mesh bed leveling algorithms. You will notice that I have allowed the printer bed to rotate 360 degrees. This implies that my cables will entangle, or I will have to pull some trick to transfer voltage and signal from the fixed parts to the rotating ones, like gimbals do. I have a bunch of ideas on this, but I will leave them for later. Just to give you a sneak peek, let me show you a couple of elements I plan to use to address this issue. In any case, I'm not sure if this 360 degree freedom will turn out to be an unnecessary complication in the build or something beneficial. I guess some testing will reveal the answer. Now, let's talk about the extruder, which doesn't exist yet. For now, I've just installed an end stop to simulate the tip of the nozzle during development. I have left the extruder out of the design so I can work on it when I need a change of piece while programming. Let's just mention now that I am aiming for a specific type of bed sensing. I want to try to implement something similar to this technique that my Carbon X1C uses. But I haven't done much research on the options so far. I have just bought these sensors from AliExpress, and I also have the weight-based ones to experiment with. I have used other types of bed probes in the past, but they always have an offset with the nozzle, which is always a hassle and one more thing to calibrate. Finally, let's give a quick mention to the end stops. I have installed one each for the X, Y, and U axis, in addition to the simulated probe. I created an enclosure that printed quite well and reused it a couple of times. I am rather pleased with the result compared to an exposed PCB. And there you have it, this is the prototype. I still got plenty more to share. I progressed with the wiring, installed Octoprint in this Raspberry Pi, and also configured Clipper. The next video will focus entirely on this. I have had to divide this episode in 2 parts, partially because editing takes me a considerable amount of time, and partially because this format allows each video to tackle a specific topic. As I prepare the next video to showcase the progress of the wiring, firmware, and more, viewers can examine the frame and perhaps point out things in the comments that I may have overlooked. In the future, I plan to establish a Discord server for this purpose, but let's make a bit more progress before that, or else every conversation would be speculative. And of course, thanks for watching and joining me on this journey. I hope to see you in a couple of days for the next segment.